Well, please feel free to take your seats or settle in from wherever you may be tuning in online. My name's Mike, and I'm so glad that we get the opportunity to share this moment together for part two of our playlist series. We're taking a look at a few of the important truths that inform our understanding of God, and then we're considering what it means to allow these truths and actually make them the loudest and most powerful influence in our life. And to help infuse these truths of God into our minds so that they reverberate in and through our lives long into the week, we've paired each message, as was mentioned in this series, with a specific song which, through melody and lyric, spotlights a truth that Scripture proclaims. And that song that we've just sung together frames the topic of our time here today. God so loved. What comes to mind when you see or hear those words? God so loved. In 2009, there was a young NFL quarterback in America who was preparing to play in the nationally televised college championship game. His name was Tim Tebow, and as a Christian, he had a personal aspiration to include, to make his faith front and center in the different areas and arenas of his life, including through his sporting career. And one small way that he did this on the biggest day of his professional sporting life up until that time was he wrote John 3:16 in the black eye paint that he wore to diminish the glare of the spotlights in the stadium. Now, one of the remarkable outcomes of his decision to do this was that throughout the duration of that game, 94 million people Googled what was etched into this young Christian's black eye paint. And for those who Googled John 3:16, these are the words that they would have seen. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. After the game and in the years since that day, Tim has been asked countless times in different interviews what the inspiration and the purpose was behind this small action that had a really significant effect. In one interview that I read, he spoke about this trend amongst many of his football teammates who wrote in their black eyeliner things of significance or what mattered most to them. And so a whole swag of them, they would write their mum's name under their eyeliner. Others, maybe their postcode, be like 3150 Glen Waverley Rules. And this was a gimmicky kind of thing, you know, that Tim did as well. But he would often put Bible verses as a source of encouragement for himself or others who happened to look his way. And as this interview that I was reading continued, though, Tim shared about a particularly strong impression from God that he sensed and that he had on the run-in to this championship game that I mentioned earlier. And this is what he said in this interview. He said, God kept bringing to my heart and my head John 3:16. Because as a Christian, that's the essence of our Christianity. It's the essence of our hope. And many Christians and Bible scholars and people who have loved Jesus through the centuries would tend to agree with what Tim just said there. Now, very few of us in this room or online are ever going or unlikely to ever find ourselves on a nationally televised stage to hundreds of millions of people while we throw a ball around. And I'm not suggesting that on the way home we stop by at the shops and pick up some sporting eyeliner. But Tim's story, it connects with our story. Because although the areas and the arenas of our life might differ to his, the same opportunity exists for the reality of God's love to be front and center in our lives. The alternative is that God's love gets pushed to the side. So if God so loved the world, what does that mean for you and for me? And what does it look like to amplify this truth in our lives today and this week and in our time to come? Well, as we turn up the volume on this topic today, we're going to be focusing on what one of the writers in the New Testament called John had to say about God's love on display to the world and to you and to me. John is the man who wrote those world-famous words of John 3:16, and it's in his account of the life of Jesus that we see John viewing and framing Jesus as central to God's expression of love and our experience of it. Now, from John's experience and perspective, Jesus is central to it all. And so it would be wise to pay attention to what he says. If you've got your Bibles, you might want to head to John chapter 1. We're going to be splashing down in a few different sections of his gospel. But to begin, John goes right back to the creation of this world to make his first point about how Jesus is the center of God's presence and activity in the world. This is how he starts his account about the life of Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him nothing that has been made was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Now, by referring to Jesus as the Word, John is sharing this understanding that at the beginning of the world and all creation, Jesus was there and central to it all, coming into his existence. And so if anyone is wanting to begin to make sense of life and this world, whether it's your meaning or purpose for existence, then John's recommendation is to start from the beginning and with who was there at the start. But John doesn't just say that Jesus was central to the creation of the world. He goes on to make this stunning statement that Jesus entered into this world as a living, breathing, walking, talking human. He writes, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." And then a few lines later, John continues to write, "No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in close relationship with the Father. He has made him known." There's this theological term called the incarnation. It often pops up a lot during the Christmas season. You should try and slip it into a conversation sometime this week. But it basically refers to the embodiment of someone or something in human form. And with these words right here, John is making this profound truth statement that Jesus is the incarnation of God. Jesus is God embodied as a human. And the point that John is making is that if anyone wants to know what God is like, then all you need to do is look at Jesus. And if you want to understand how God views or responds to and interacts with the world and with all of humanity, then all you need to do is look at Jesus. And when you look at Jesus, you'll see how God is not some far-off, disinterested, all-powerful being. Rather, he's present and he's invested and he's involved in this world that he created. When you look at Jesus, you'll see a God who is able to remain both powerful and sovereign, but also intentionally personal and relational. And when we look at Jesus, we see how God responds to the problem of evil, both in the world and within our own lives. Now, as John continued to paint his picture of the life and purpose of Jesus, he recorded the response of another man called John the Baptist. Clearly, it was a popular name that year. Now, John the Baptist, he lived at the same time as Jesus, and when he encountered Jesus, this is how he responded. "The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him, and he said, 'Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Now, John the Baptist, he is famous for a few things in the New Testament of the Bible, but the key role that he has was to prepare and point people towards Jesus. And on this particular day, when he sees Jesus, he refers to him as the Lamb of God. Fee actually spoke about this in her sermon last week. One of the titles of Jesus is the Lamb of God. We actually sung about it this morning as well. The Lamb of God, the one who would take responsibility for the problem of sin in this world and who on the cross endures the penalty and pays the price for the sins of all humanity. That's what John the Baptist is publicly stating right here. Look at Jesus. He is the one sent by God to deal with the problem of sin in our world. Sin can be a tricky word, can't it? It's a pretty widely known or referred term, particularly within religious circles, but it's also a word that unfortunately has been used as a weapon by people against others. And often sin is a word used as a weapon by someone who at the same time often is turning a blind eye to their own mistakes or perhaps painting over the cracks or holes in their own lives. And this is why when it comes to thinking through and understanding sin, I really like the definition that's given by Timothy Keller. He's a pastor and author from New York. I find it to be particularly helpful because it defines the root problem of what the Bible calls sin. This is what Keller writes. Sin is looking to something else besides God for your salvation. It's putting yourself in the place of God, becoming your own Savior and Lord, as it were. And so when we view it through this lens, the issue of sin and the problem of evil in our world stems from an internal tendency that we all, if we're honest, struggle with. It's an inclination to locate meaning or maybe define success or justify our life in something other than God. One common way that this presents itself in our life is through the lengths that we'll go to in the pursuit of pleasure and happiness. So this makes things like sex or money or power the center of our lives. If we can have it or more of it, then maybe we'll have enough to save us. Maybe it'll give us the sense that our life means something, that our life matters. And in the process of pursuing these things, we make ourselves our own Savior and Lord because we think that we can source or provide for ourselves what we need the most. But there's also a sneaky religious way that can be just as sinful and destructive. The religious way is when we take our good life or our moral achievements and then we present them to God as proof and credit so that He in turn owes us to bless us and maybe answer our prayers in the way that we want. This reduces God to no more than a vending machine for our desires and our wishes because we source the significance and security on the basis of the good that we do. And in the process, we make ourselves our own Savior and Lord, because we think that we can source and provide for ourselves what we need most. The tragedy is that both pathways inevitably leads to disappointment and destruction. It's just what happens when we take things other than God and we make them central to our lives. Inevitably, our lives and the world around us get bent out of shape because of our sin and the sin of others. And this is why John writes his gospel account about the life of Jesus, because he is utterly convinced that in Jesus we find the solution to the problem of sin, and in Jesus we find the one who can heal us of our sin. What follows over the next few pages of John's gospel is a number of encounters that Jesus has with people, and there's a common sequence of events that unfolds. Firstly, Jesus will meet someone where they're at. And then with grace and truth, he begins to reveal the particular ways in which their sin has bent them out of shape. And then Jesus invites them to recognize him as their Savior, who can deal with their sin and change their life forever if they choose to respond and believe in him. Here's what happens in just one of these encounters. In John chapter 3, Jesus receives a visit in the middle of the night from a man called Nicodemus. Now, as a member of the Jewish ruling council, he's a Pharisee. On face value, Nicodemus is a prosperous, he is devout, he's a very honorable man. But he's come to Jesus under the cover of darkness because he's trying to privately work out who Jesus is and what that means for his own religious beliefs. And through a process of asking a few rhetorical questions, Jesus diagnoses and begins to reveal the point of sin in Nicodemus's life. He presses Nicodemus on this smug self-satisfaction that he has because of his good religious pedigree. And because Nicodemus thinks that it's his good morals or his religious integrity that makes him right with God. He slipped into this way of thinking that, well, then God will do right by him. Nicodemus is a classic example of sin in the religious way of becoming your own savior. And so to this sinful man, Jesus says, you need a new kind of life, an internal life that you've been missing out on so far, and that eternal life can only be found when you believe in me. And it's immediately after this encounter between Jesus and Nicodemus that the writer John adds in his own commentary about what's just happened with these now famous words of John 3:16 and perhaps the lesser well-known words of verse 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. It's a powerful statement, isn't it? And it reveals the essence of the Christian hope and faith that despite my sin, your sin, and the sin of the world, God's love leads to a solution through the person and the work of Jesus. Remember, John has been building this argument over how central Jesus is to this world and our lives since the very beginning of his gospel. Firstly, Jesus was central in the creation of this world. And so if you want to start discovering the purpose or meaning of life, then look to the one who was present at the start. Secondly, Jesus is central to how we understand God. Because Jesus is God incarnate, then if you want to know what God is like, then all you need to do is look at him and look at Jesus. And then thirdly, Jesus is central to God's response to the problem of sin in our world and in our life. Jesus, who would come to earth, he'd live a perfect life and then willingly sacrifice his life on a cross to pay the penalty for our sins and then rise to resurrection life a few days later. And the outcome of this all, in Jesus, we see the full and powerful display of God's love for the world. And when we come to believe for ourselves who Jesus is and trust and accept the truth that only Jesus can be our Savior and source for salvation, then we receive and experience what Jesus and John both refer to as eternal life. It's a new quality of life that's infused with God's eternal love. It starts now and it lasts into eternity. And this is the truly good news of Jesus. Because it's in him that we can both know and experience the love of God. The question is, how loud is this truth playing in our lives at the moment? And is it truly the central truth of your life? A couple of months ago when we started the Revelation series that we did here at Syndal called Love Letters, our senior pastor, Chris, he led us through a reflection activity during the first sermon. And it involved us thinking back on the time when we first began to believe in Jesus. Maybe you remember doing it. Now for me, that reflection activity, it took me back to when I was 14 or 15. Now my parents, in particular my mum, did a great job of raising me with an awareness of Jesus. But I would say that the moment when this shifted from an awareness to something that actually began to change my life occurred in my teen years when I was at a youth rally. And I remember a speaker sharing this very same good news of God's loving response to sin through Jesus. And then when there was an invitation to make a decision in response to this good news, I decided to believe and follow Jesus for myself. And the next little period of time of my life, it was this exhilarating roller coaster ride of discovering what it meant to live as a Christian and begin to experience this new eternal life with Jesus. But then later in my teen years, the passion began to fade. And though I still believed and I would have said that I loved Jesus, other things just began to crowd him out. And at some stage, I honestly can't remember who it was or where it happened, but I was sitting with a Christian who was a few years down the road in their own faith journey. And they spoke to me about the power and the importance of daily living in light of the good news of Jesus. They reminded me that our own personal struggles with sin, they don't just stop the minute that we become a Christian. And so we need to keep the truth about God's response to sin through Jesus on repeat in our lives. And then they suggested, I was a teenager, so they gave me a really simple, practical way to put this truth on repeat in my life. It was in the form of a regular prayer that helped to remind myself of my ongoing need to keep Jesus at the center. And it's called the Gospel Prayer. It's written by a guy called J.D. Greer, who is credited to writing it in this particular form. And it's meant to be prayed in conversation with God, and it goes like this. In prayer, God, in Christ, there is nothing I can do that would make you love me more, and nothing that I've done that makes you love me less. In Christ, your presence and approval are all that I need, God, for today, for everlasting joy. As you have been to me, so I will be to others. And as I pray, I'll measure your compassion by the cross and your power by the resurrection. And it's a prayer that's remained relatively consistent in my life these past 15 or so years, because it functions as a practical and tangible way of reminding myself about the reality of what it means to have Jesus as Savior and Lord. It's been particularly powerful when I've found myself distancing my relationship with God because of sin, or just because of I just get caught up in the midst of the daily noise of life. And something as simple as this gospel prayer on repeat, it reminds me on my best days and my worst days that I need to keep Jesus central in my life. At other times, turning the volume up on the good news of Jesus so that it resonates, this truth in my life. It's practically involved things like reading and thinking about different passages of Scripture like John 3:16. It either assures me of God's love or it reminds me of my need to keep Jesus central in my life. Sometimes it's involved listening to music that communicates these very same truths that we've unpacked in the Bible today. Because God so loved the world, anyone can respond to him just like the song that we sung before proclaims. So bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. Now that's a strong song to strengthen your faith and belief this coming week. Those are some of the practical ways that the truth of God's love are put on repeat in my life. So what could it look like for you to put them on repeat in yours? Whether you've been following Jesus for decades or whether you're not sure what you believe, what could it look like to put the truth of God's love on repeat in your life this week? Now, to help give you some options that you can take with you into your week and just try them on and see what fits, if you head to our Connect link at me.sb.org.au at any time today or this week, you'll find a few resources that have been put together for you. Firstly, we've compiled a Spotify playlist of songs that will help infuse into your life the truth of God's love. And then there's also a passage playlist. It features a snapshot of additional verses from the Bible that you might want to reflect on this week. And you'll also be able to see a copy of the Gospel Prayer by J.D. Greer as well. But to close out our time in this service right now, we've got the chance to actually put this truth on repeat together in a few practical ways. To begin with, we're going to participate in communion together. Now, hopefully on the way into your auditorium today, you would have received one of these communion cups that contains juice and a wafer. Now, there's no way of doing this reverently, okay? So let's take a few moments to peel the clear plastic seal off the top, and you'll be able to access the wafer and just maybe put that to the side and get it ready for you. If you're watching from home online, you might want to take this opportunity to get some communion prepared for you. And then once you've peeled off this clear plastic seal, just half crack open the foil seal so that you've got easy access to the juice when it comes to drinking together a little bit later on. I've royally stuffed this one up, so all right. How are we doing? All right. Now, as we prepare to participate in communion, let's read how Jesus frames this practice in Matthew chapter 26. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." And then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Now, when we take part in communion, we remember Jesus' death on a cross. The cracker represents the body of Jesus, and the juice represents the blood of Jesus that's poured out for your forgiveness and mine. And communion gives us a powerful opportunity to reflect on what that means for us as we recognize our continuing need for a Savior. So as we take a moment to reflect, the opening words of an incredible song is just going to lightly play in the background. And in this time, you're invited to eat the cracker in your own time and just hold on to the cup so that we can drink together at the end. But in this moment, let's focus our minds and direct our hearts as we remember again God's love for us, embodied and displayed through Jesus on the cross.
The great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head, the Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross, lifted up on Calvary. We cursed your name, and even still, you bore our shame and paid the cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross.
And now, let's drink the cup with a thankful heart, for God so loved the world. Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you for who you are and what you do in our world and in our lives. And it's in light of what your death, burial, and resurrection has accomplished for us and for the eternal life that we can have with you, that we ask that you might help us to live with you as the center of our lives. When our sin pushes you aside, would you make us aware of that? Would you call us back to you? And would you give us the confidence and the assurance to respond because of the truth of your love for us all? And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, to close out our service, we get the chance to be led by the band in a reprise of that song that we just sung earlier. So let's stand. Maybe sing a little louder, and let's proclaim the truth of God's love for the world.